Okay, so we're recording a meeting, a planning meeting for the Gasifier workshop with Dan Hartman and Marcin from Open Source Ecology.
Yep.
So we're discussing what will the scope of this workshop be. So one thing we mentioned just now was that we make a gasifier that works in our setting. We try to make it as generalizable as possible by using a construction set approach. And of course, people will have to adapt that to their own environments, which is exactly the case for open source source code, which allows someone to take that and make adaptations as a natural product. But one thing that we do think about in a set is, so the pelletizer is one of the tools, right? And one route, if you want to get really almost like space age on this, is if you use a very high quality feedstock like pellets or charcoal pellets that are made from wood pellets, that'll be one way that you can totally tighten the control on a lot of the issues, like, for example, making the tiniest burner, or making like a small application that can be used as a cooking stove. I think the pellets allow you to have much more flexibility because they're highly flowable and augurable, and with low tech, with readily available tools from the pellet industry. That's one way to do it, and that would be like the eventual one avenue to explore. I personally think that it would be quite promising if the pelletizer is part of the thing, that we've got a sawmill running, we've got plenty of wood, sawdust, or whatever, that we can actually do that. There'll be one application that can lend itself to a lot of applications, such as including like bicycles. Like I've seen people make steam engine bicycles and things like that. So that's one way to go. But back to scoping out for the workshop itself, yeah, char maker of some sort. We want to do a crude version. So then what would be some other versions we'd want to make? I mean, is it realistic in any way that we can actually perhaps consider? Well, I mean, this would go into the scope of this, but I mean, I think the fuel feed auger is something I have as item number 6. Like, first of all, we have to do a burn chamber, right? We got to burn stuff. We got to get air in there. We got to get gas out. We got to have a nozzle. A hopper, we can separate the burn chamber from the hopper, perhaps. I mean, so this would be a decision to make. Is it possible to make a minimum burn chamber and then the actual barrel is around that? So we actually make this burn chamber module, which probably has the nozzle, the inlet, but it doesn't actually have the container. I don't know. I don't know enough about the burn chambers, but let's maybe discuss what the burn chamber would look like.
Yeah. In the charcoal gasification, at least in the Gilmore design, there's practically nothing in the barrel. Mm-hmm. Like that Lumina that you saw on my website.
Yep.
There's almost nothing in the barrel.
Right.
As far as, you know, if you compare it to, say, the Ember wood gasifier, which has nozzles and it has a cone-shaped hearth and lots of complicated stuff.
Mm-hmm.
The charcoal gasifier has almost nothing in there. There's a hearth, which is, in my case, it's 4 fire bricks.
Mm-hmm.
Right at the bottom that kind of surround the air inlet.
Can you send a link to that? Let's see. That's on your blog. Let's see. Let me see if I can pull that up. So let's see. Okay, charcoal powered. I see that there, the Chevy Lumina. Is there a picture of the bricks there on that blog post? Yeah, I see that. Okay, so you got the filter, the mounting. You got the bricks. So the bricks there are. Can you explain that? Because they have an opening to the side, and they're standing off the bottom. Oh, so that's where the nozzle is going into. You just have a protected area where the burn just happens, period. That's it. You just stick a tube into there.
Right. Okay, mm-hmm. The very second picture, if you go clear to the top of the page, it shows a view down into a barrel.
Yep.
And at the very bottom, there's a...
Yep, the tube.
A shiny galvanized pipe.
Yep.
The reason that won't work is that pipe will melt.
Yep.
So then I stacked a fire brick box around where that pipe is instead.
Do you have the pipe there still and then the firebox?
No.
No pipe.
The pipe,
so what's...
is gone and just the fitting on the side of the barrel. And the fire brick is stacked against the side of the barrel so that the one end of the box is against the side with that red high temp sealant.
Mm-hmm.
And the other end just ends right close to the center of the barrel. And that's it. And you fill this whole thing from bottom to top with charcoal. And there's a filter made with fiberglass insulation that wraps around that steel mesh.
Mm-hmm.
And the design doesn't have to be this. We can improve things about the design if there's something to improve. There probably are some things we can make better. Some people, instead of having the intake come in from the side, they'll just put some fire brick against the bottom of the barrel and drill a hole right into the bottom. But I'm a little concerned about embers falling out with that method. I'm not sure how they deal with that.
Yeah.
I
think the side is good because how are you going to light it? I mean, that's an issue.
Yeah. With the barrel, with the fire bricks, you just poke. I have a bent piece of wire that I put a piece of burning rag or burning paper towel with, I might put some isopropyl alcohol or some gasoline or something on the end of this wire with the rag.
Or,
stick it in there.
Or a propane torch?
Propane torch is a little bit short, but if you had one with a long nozzle that you could stick in there.
Mm-hmm.
That would work, yes.
Right. So if we go for the absolute simplicity in this, that's what we'd want to do, just a barrel. And so the cyclone would be an addition. What you have here, you'd put a cyclone on in addition to this filter?
Right. Or just eliminate the filter and have all the dust, most of the dust collected by the cyclone, and then have another filter after the cyclone that catches what the cyclone didn't catch.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And there's probably better designs, but this is, I attribute this to the Gary Gilmore design. I mean, it's just nothing but a container.
Mm-hmm.
And
right.
It's not a whole lot. It's not a whole lot that can go wrong with it, but the fire brick I tend to get leaks between the side of the barrel, the fire brick. And you notice how the barrel is scorched?
Yeah.
You just get a hot barrel then. It still works, but... It burns the paint off the side of the barrel, and I think possibly when the charcoal isn't reacting in the zone where you designed for it to react, then you have it reacting other places, which might not be optimal.
Okay, so let's maybe go to the document and just kind of draw out what the burn zone is really like. See the fire brick. So we'd want to go. So in this implementation, I mean, if we look at the form factor, like say it's a power cube hung on to the side of the, well, it's the gasifier is going to be a cube hung onto the side of the power cube. or stacked on top. That's one of the decisions to make. If you want to make it practical, it's probably good that we put it on a, I mean, do you think it would work on the top? I mean, it gets a little vertically tall.
Yeah.
But on the sides, the challenge is that, well, you can't really stack more power cubes together. It gets you definite space considerations, issues. Mm-hmm. But let's see. So the theory. Let's maybe start a pictures new slide. So then the burn. Let's talk about the burn chamber. So let's just draw a simple diagram. So basically, there's a. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Are you familiar with Google Docs?
Not really.
So you can, I mean, you can edit them. You can.
Right. Yeah, I just can take probably work with it a little bit.
Take
here.
The shapes. So that's the nozzle, or the fitting into the side. You have. You have your fire bricks. So basically, the fire bricks. The concept is that the charcoal. So this is like right against the side.
Yep.
And then the charcoal just. Pretty much just falls down, like into this edge. Charcoal falls in, like basically it caves in like a mountain.
Yep.
And it just burns there. And there would be like a, let's see, maybe let's look
you
at
get
the
trunk. Sloping in a little bit like this.
Uh-huh. So you'd have a slope of charcoal in there, like it kind of goes in.
Yeah. That line that I just drew is like the fire brick that's against the very bottom.
Mm-hmm. So you can get
so
rid of that line.
So then what you have is
yeah.
up at the top.
So kind of
a curvy line.
Uh-huh. Okay. So basically we have charcoal.
Yeah.
Have you studied what happens like with the meltdown, like the tube won't work? What does Gary Gilmore do for the meltdown?
Tries to make a ceramic tube, which I've tried as well.
Mm-hmm.
With my tractor, let me see if I put pictures of that on the article about the tractor.
So that's the charcoal level on top?
Yeah. That'll drop down as the charcoal is consumed. And if you want it to last longer, you could stack another barrel right on top of it, and
yeah.
it would be twice as tall.
Where's the gas exit?
Okay.
In the top.
Yeah, in my case, it would be... Here, let me get a shape.
The filter was at the top in your case, right? So the... Yeah.
And then you would load
So I think in this case, because we want to make it more modular, especially for with the idea of getting a jacket. I mean, I'd like to consider the possibility of a jacket around this at some point. How do we design for jacket? I mean, it's not, right now we don't have so much jacketability here, but let's just keep that in mind that, so, i.e. make it like potentially able to do that in the future. So maybe, so here, just take the tube out and put a cyclone on it. Yeah.
Yeah. What do you mean by a jacket?
Like a coil. That would be a water heat exchanger, which, say this chamber is hot. That you can wrap a coil around it.
Yeah, you don't get much heat. Let me draw a circle for you.
And if that's the case, what would the design look like that around the burn chamber you actually do have a coil? So, okay, so that's going to be your burn zone?
Yeah, if everything's working right, there isn't much more heat than that.
Okay.
What happens if you get a leak? Get air leaking right here.
Mm-hmm.
Then you get
heat there.
You get a lot of heat right here.
Yeah.
And then it scorches the side of the barrel. So if everything's working right, you should be able to put your hand on the side of the barrel and it's fairly warm.
Right.
And the gas outlet, most, if not all, of the heat, the reaction zone is used up, turning carbon into carbon monoxide. And you can put your hand on the gas outlet and it's barely warm.
So proper design has most of the, or like the perfect design would have the limit of,
yeah.
It's a thermal reaction, so you need the heat to knock off the carbon monoxide, to turn
right.
Carbon into carbon monoxide. So
yep.
The reaction there is carbon goes to carbon monoxide, and what? What else? Where's the hydrogen coming from?
There's no hydrogen unless you inject water.
Mm-hmm. So in an ideal case, carbon goes to carbon monoxide, and that's your fuel?
It's turning the solid carbon of the charcoal is turning straight into carbon monoxide.
Why is it not turning into carbon dioxide?
Because carbon really wants to grab an oxygen. It actually does. The air that first hits the fire down here in the burn zone. The air that comes in the intake and hits that burn zone turns to carbon dioxide. That's where all the heat comes from for the reaction. And once you have carbon dioxide and you have lots of heat, then the carbon, the charcoal with hot carbon dioxide flowing through it, it wants to grab one of the oxygen off of the carbon dioxide and it turns it into carbon monoxide. It's amazing how much the heat has to do with that.
So it actually, what happens is C goes to CO2, but then it's stripped by the next carbon?
Yeah, you have combustion, which with oxygen makes oxygen and carbon makes CO2 when you have combustion.
Right.
And that makes lots of heat. And it is very, very hot. It'll melt steel. And it'll turn fire brick to glass. In one of my videos I showed pictures of what the heat did to my fire brick. It actually,
is that on the same blog? Same blog post?
The edges of them to a wet, glassy looking substance.
Can you send a link of that?
Yeah, YouTube video. One moment.
Yeah. So I was looking at, just for your reference, I was doing some calculations. So just to refer you to that, and page number one has the OSE workshops page, the documentation spreadsheet, and the Gasifier wiki page. So the wiki page is the general page for the Gasifier. Documentation spreadsheet is where we actually document the different design points. Like actually, if you click on it, it takes you to a little spreadsheet, and there's a calculations, number 11. I went through some calculations, and it appears that I don't understand why people are saying that charcoal versus wood takes up more volume for the same energy content, because the energy density of wood is about half that of charcoal by weight. However, charcoal is about half as dense as wood chips.
Right, it's like balsa wood, it's real light.
Yeah, it's lighter. It's half, twice as light. So it's got twice more energy, but it's twice as light. So for the same amount of weight, that's actually going to be the same, well, for the same amount of energy, because it's got twice as much energy, it's going to be the same volume. So I'm not getting the concept of why people say that it's more effective to, you have more energy that you can carry in a given volume when you run on wood. Can you enlighten me on that?
Yeah, just the wood is more dense. It still has the tar. When you make charcoal, you lose half of it. You lose half the energy or half the fuel or more.
No, I understand that. I understand that point, but you end up with a product that's 30 megajoules per kilogram by weight versus wood, which is about 15 megajoules per kilogram. So you got twice as much energy per weight. Now the density, the amount of weight in that barrel is going to be half for the charcoal, but that balances out. You got twice as much energy, but half the weight. So you end up being just about the same as wood.
Yeah, I don't know then. I can't explain it.
Yeah, so I think that what I'm going to do is I'm going to go to the burn wood. What's that forum? The run on wood?
Drive on wood.
I'll go to drive on wood and try to get some clarity there, because, I mean, the numbers say that it should be equivalent. So I'd like them to point out what am I doing wrong here. I think the claim is that, I've heard the claim that everyone drives on wood because you can get more mileage out of the same tank, right? That's what everyone says?
Oh, I don't know. It's not what I say.
Well, I don't say that either, but I heard a lot of people say that that they're running, or at least a few people that I've talked to about this, the wood gas proponents are telling me that. So I don't know. We got to really clarify that point, because I think there's confusion around that. Mm-hmm. Okay. So I see your video.
I'll send you a picture. I have to take a shot from my video.
Mm-hmm.
That shows the part where the fire brick is. Yeah, here we go.
Yeah, I see this slag. So you get slag there of the ash. I mean, the ash just solidifies into slag.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
And if there's any steel, like if there's nails, fire brick for the top.
Yeah. It'll be just.
Yeah, they'll be melted.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's good. It addresses the tractor tires. Okay. And the ash. Okay, let's see. So, okay, so you got the picture of, you got what, chunks of metal in there? It looks wet. So explain that picture for a sec.
Yeah. The wet part is the fire brick.
Mm-hmm.
And there's whatever the aggregate was that they used in the concrete. It's some kind of a concrete mixture.
Mm-hmm.
Ceramic or something that they make fire brick out of. And it's just the, yeah, it's just the stones and grit, whatever that's...
Yeah, wow.
Fire brick is made of.
Yeah. Okay.
And when you react charcoal with air, there's actually too much heat. There's more heat than necessary.
Now, is that heat, is the goal of a proper design to take that heat and throttle down? So basically you need to throttle down the oxygen intake?
Yes, if you can, one thing you can do is take exhaust,
yeah,
which has carbon dioxide,
mm-hmm,
and put carbon dioxide into the intake.
Wait, so you're actually burning the exhaust fumes?
Well,
so the carbon dioxide goes back to carbon monoxide when...
Yeah, then you take carbon dioxide from the exhaust and put it back in there, and because there's more heat than necessary, it can use up, it can take that extra heat and break off the oxygen from the exhaust gas.
And what happens to that oxygen that was broken off to the carbon monoxide? It actually burns that with more carbon?
Yeah, it helps. It helps to...
Oh, wow.
It helps use up some of the heat. So,
right.
You tend to think of exhaust as being hot.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a little bit warm, of course, coming out of the engine.
Right.
But when you pipe some of it back into that intake, it actually cools down the charcoal combustion.
Right. So you've got, in a car exhaust, in an ideal case, you have carbon dioxide and water.
Yeah.
So the
There won't be much water if you're running on carbon. Running on carbon monoxide, there won't, and you don't have hydrogen, then there won't be water in the exhaust.
Oh yeah. So you got pretty much what happens when a CO burns. It pretty much goes to CO2, and that's the pretty much the.
Yeah. When you use CO as fuel, you're getting CO2 then, because you're just reacting it with oxygen.
So in that case, you're actually, in this reactor system, you're actually ending up burning the CO2 again, which is...
A little bit of it.
Most of it just goes away, or...
Yeah, you can't get more than about 19%. If you put in too much exhaust, it'll just put the fire out.
So you're actually recycling 19% of the exhaust energy?
Yeah, roughly.
Something like that? That's very interesting.
Here's a link that you should study if you want to know more of the chemistry of, and some of the studies of the charcoal gasifier, right here. Kaylee, I don't know how you say that. That's where or maybe it's 17%. I think 17% is right. This image right here.
And what kind of gasifier is that? Is that
charcoal?
Okay, and that's for the during the Second World War.
Yeah, I think so. So that's a really complicated design that he experimented with a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And it addressed a lot of the problems with excess heat that were burning up the intake. Instead of using fire brick, he's just using a pipe with as much CO2 as he could to help preserve the end of the pipe. And then his exit, the way that he was getting the CO gas out, is kind of unique. Just goes through a screen. So,
okay.
It's a good design, but it's just complicated and it's hard. I never really considered my skills. Like, there's that diaphragm thing. This image here. There's a diaphragm that moves the nozzle up and down depending on how hard you're stepping on the gas.
Oh, yeah. So basically a full feedback on for control of combustion.
Now that's, you know, that takes a lot of hardware and, you know, special seals and lots of little bits and pieces to make that work. So my experience is more simplistic, more like Gary Gilmore. You know, he came up with just a very simple design that just works.
And what I mean, the thing that we might want to have to get it tuned in, I mean, it's just getting the valve to the right throttle, the air valve, the air intake, or
yeah,
which is, if that works, that's fine. For constant RPM, that's fine. We don't have to worry about throttling up and down at this point. We don't need that right now.
Once you get the mixture set right, the throttling is fine. Like my tractor, it had the same governor that the harder it worked, the more it opened up the throttle. Everything still worked, right?
It opened up the air intake?
Yeah, just the same throttle that it used when it was running on gas. And the governor, it has a centrifugal governor. Everything, all that stuff stayed the same.
So in Illumina, the governor was the original engine governor?
Well, it just had a gas pedal. When you had the mixture set right, you could step on the gas or let off, and it acted just like it was running on gasoline. Everything same.
But it was actually running on the gas, the char gas?
Yeah.
Oh, wow. Yeah. So in principle, so if we have, let's see, the engines we're using right now, do they have a throttle? Yeah, right.
They probably have a governor that it runs at 3,600 RPM, and that's that. I don't know. Maybe they have a throttle. But most engines on, like, lawnmower engines and small engines like that, snowblower, rototiller, all those kinds of engines usually have a governor that when you set the throttle, you're actually setting the governor, and which operates a spring that pulls against the centrifugal flyweights. So if you get into some tough mowing or get into some tough tilling, it opens the throttle for you. You don't have to sit there and work the throttle.
Right.
And with a gasifier, that part stays all the same.
Yeah. Okay. Good. So, okay, so back to the design here. So in this instance, we're therefore going to essentially the simple burn chamber design. Is that something we want to reevaluate for now or just do that? Because I know that Crossfire, the Troy Martz's gasifier, he uses the ceramic nozzle to make that work. Let's see. Let me see if that's on our wiki.
That's fine. I don't really care. You can change anything you want.
I mean, is it realistic, or does that, first of all, does that work in our application, or what's the simplest way to do it here? Because a nozzle like that, if that does work and it's relevant to our case, that would be attractive. But the first question is, do we have access to that? Is that open source? Let's see. Let's see, open fire on the wiki. Troy Mart's Gasifier, it's this here. Let's see, do we have the, so there's the, he's showing the, nozzle element. Okay, so that's what? That's for TIG welder nozzle. If we have something like that, would that address the melting problem? If there's a tube going from the bottom of that and then goes, a tube goes, is teed from the bottom of that? Do you think that would address the issue?
It might.
Right.
If he's proven it, if he's run it, you know, there's a nice drawing there. I don't know if he actually proved it.
Yeah, he did. I mean, this thing is running. He runs this. He's shown this running. I think he says it works.
Yeah. There you go then.
Yeah, look at that. So he's got the ceramic insulation. So basically he's got a very small burn zone. And let's see, the air is coming above the nozzle. But how do you prevent that from clogging up? I mean, there's details there. There's ash. Okay, ash goes in the bottom. What if air goes down the nozzle? What if the charcoal goes down the nozzle? What happens then? Do you see an issue there?
The only problem I see with that is if it falls down in, it falls out the bottom of the thing and catches your field on fire. You know, if you're in a forest.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you're in a dry field with dry grass or something and you have embers falling out of it onto the ground and you step on, you know, maybe you're barefoot and you step on glowing embers, or maybe it starts your field on fire or something like that. And he's using steam injection there, water, to help control the heat. That also puts hydrogen into his mix.
Mm-hmm.
That's fine. That's not a bad design. What I've found though is if my charcoal will get damp.
Mm-hmm.
If there's water. If there's steam going out in the exhaust. One of the problems that the Lumina has is that it's got a small coolant leak in one of the cylinders. It's an old thing that's got, I don't know, probably 200,000 miles.
Mm-hmm.
And so there's a little bit of water vapor that goes out in the exhaust. And that helps cool the reaction, but it also makes the charcoal damp when you shut it down. The hydrogen that's in there eventually reacts with oxygen, turns back into water. But that wasn't even really a big problem, except maybe it was a little hard to start it up again with damp charcoal. It was a little bit hard to start again.
Yeah.
That wasn't a big problem.
Yep, I'm reading the comments down there. Let's see, can we find a, that would be a, first of all, can we find this nozzle? So ceramic, let's see, let me look at my email, what he said about that. I mean, do you feel that, I mean, okay, so that, I mean, this is, it's getting dangerous, because, I mean, if we want to do this now, we haven't done this, so this is not good.
It looks too small. That's the only thing. The concern of mine is that it looks small.
Right. How? What's the ideal, like, if you had an air hole to suck through this, or to insert the air, what do you have a feeling for what the air hole should be to get, say, 27 horsepower?
Not really. My tractor had a 1-inch pipe, which is nominal, a 1-inch steel pipe, which is probably more like 1.25 inches on the outside. It might be 1 inch on the inside and 1.25 inches on the outside. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And then the lumina was 1.5 inches. And that seemed to work in both cases. It seemed about right. But again, my science and my mathematics probably wasn't very exact, but it worked.
Yeah. No, I mean, I think there's probably a lot of experimentation going on. If we have 27 horsepower, he wasn't talking about 27 horsepower. He was talking about half of that or something like that. He said his design would overheat in our case if we tried to run it. Well, he hasn't done that.
And the lumina, that might have been closer to 27 horsepower. The engine itself is a lot more powerful than that, but, you know, when running on gasoline, but I might not have been getting much more than that out of it.
I see.
1.5 inches. Might have been getting 30 or 40 horse. But it didn't have just an awful lot of power. And some of the reason for that is because the size of the hose that went all the way from the back bumper all the way up the full length of the vehicle to the front.
Mm-hmm.
That was 1.5 inches sewer hose, which is plastic corrugated. A lot of friction of air moving, you know, of the gas moving through that has a lot of resistance.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Ceramic welding nozzles, yeah, I mean, check this out. I mean, there's definitely ways around it in the sense that you can just, in your piping, just put two of them, and that would
right.
be fine. If one of them is too small. Now, in fact, it might be a good strategy for scalability. So we can say, okay, here's our piping. Now we're going to use 1, 2, or 3 nozzles for air injection, and we can have decent control. Yeah. So when you look online, there's a ton of these different nozzles. They have ones that are like up to about 3/4 inches. I'm looking at 1 3/4 hole at the top of that nozzle. Let's see. ID. So say we got about 3/4 inches. I mean, that's quite a bit. We can make 1 or 2 of them. But what's your feeling? I mean, basically, Troy, I asked him if he could help out on this. He said he wasn't available. He's moving and doing other things. Do you think we can figure this out? Or it makes it too risky for having something to work? I mean, it's...
Yeah, the thing that makes me nervous is if at the workshop we're still trying to figure out.
Yeah, no, we gotta, no, forget about it. We gotta go, no risk area here. Let's just do the fire brick, which we know works. So let's save this for later. I mean, this is definitely where we want to just get something that works and is going to be a first proof of concept that this is feasible. I think what we can do is get basic. I would avoid modifying the engine, because if we want to modify the engine, one that's much deeper, and when we were thinking about modifying, we would have to change it back to gasoline, and that's kind of like a deep change. So we remove the gasoline ability, because if we leave it at the crappy power that we're gonna get, it'll still run the tractor, because the tractor, we even ran it on a one horsepower power cube, and the tractor still runs, but very slowly. It's still got the torque. On one horsepower, it's got 4,000 pounds of pushing torque still. So, and here we'll have, say we have, instead of 27 horsepower, we have 13 horsepower. I mean, we'll still, if that's the proof of concept, I mean, that's still okay. So let's maybe forget about it for now, because we don't have the technical support right now for that. And it's questionable whether Troy is open sourcing that or not. I mean, we had discussion about this, and he pretty much pulled the open source project, and he focused on the closed source version. So currently, as it stands, we don't have the access. And I can talk to him more about that, where he stands right now, at a later point. Okay, so let's just do the fire brick. Now, if we do the fire brick, so that's, any thoughts on closing up that gap on the side?
Yeah.
So how do we do that?
Let me draw some lines here.
Mm-hmm. And it's the air leak that's the trouble, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Everything else is perfect.
Now, do you fix that fire brick in place somehow, or how do you prevent it from?
I used fire brick mortar between the bricks themselves.
Okay.
I don't like this Google drawing thing.
Mm-hmm.
And then that high temperature red silicone.
Okay. Yeah.
Use that to seal the bricks to the barrel. And I use that red stuff. Lots of places. One thing is that it's not oxygen sensor safe.
Mm-hmm.
So for a vehicle, that's probably not good, but my Lumina runs anyway, and I never have any problems. But that red stuff is supposedly bad for oxygen sensors.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So
I can't draw with this thing. I'm going to have to make you some DeltaCAD. I use DeltaCAD, which is not open source.
Uh-huh.
But, I'm gonna have to use that, because I can't draw with this thing.
Yeah.
What I was gonna suggest is to weld a steel box
mm-hmm.
to the side of the barrel on the inside
mm-hmm.
and fasten the fire bricks around it. Earlier you asked about
okay, I see what you're saying.
You asked if that tube was inside of the fire bricks still.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not, but that's probably a good idea if that tube from the outside went all the way in
mm-hmm.
And could be surrounded by fire bricks.
Well, I think
things that I've tried is to coat that pipe with refractory cement,
uh-huh.
which is like fire brick that you can put on like a cement, and then it hardens when it gets hot.
Yeah. How did that work?
And that's good. This picture, just a minute, let me find there's a picture on my website.
Mm-hmm.
Let's try.
Yeah, so somehow we got to put in a ceramic element. You got the fire brick, there's the nozzle idea.
Okay, on the tractor page. Try to get the URL.
Mm-hmm.
Here we go.
Well, you know what? I mean, if we're inserting a tube there, can you tell me a little more about, I mean, maybe we can play around with the geometry. I mean, do you understand the kind of like the burn zone? I mean, essentially, it's you got air going in there, and wherever the air is going to be passing by, it's going to make the charcoal really hot, right? So what if we tried? Okay, I see. So you got some wire mesh.
So then you coat that all up with refractory cement.
Did that work? Did you end up trying that?
Yeah, it burned out.
It's still burned out? Okay. Now that's your air tube, right? So what if, let's see.
It took a long time, but it eventually burned out. It actually worked pretty good on the tractor.
When you say it burned out, how much time?
Maybe 10 hours of use,
Okay.
which is quite a few hours, actually. It seemed like a long time, you know. I mean, I didn't do it all in one day. It was maybe 5 or 6 different runs of the gasifier.
In order to get some technical support on this, do you know some people in the charcoal community who we can ask about this? I mean, who can we ask for more suggestions on this? I mean, I'm sure someone's got this nailed, or do you think someone's got it nailed, or?
No, I'm not really sure. I hadn't done a whole lot with this. When you contacted me, it had been a little while since I did a lot with this. So I
But what
haven't
if?
been on the drive on wood forums in a
Okay, so let me run
course.
this one by you. So today I was looking at the. Do you know the King of Random?
Yeah, that rings a bell. Do
So
I see
there's
too many of those?
YouTube. Yeah, there was one YouTube about the ceramic furnace, an arc furnace. And I think what we can do is what he did. So basically, get solid block. Let's see. Let me show you this because I think this might be worth. He basically shows how you can take these fire blocks, and I don't know what they are. It's whether it's the same as what you're
There are
doing.
some mind-blowing loopholes in this version of life.
Let's see. So let's search for arc furnace. Okay. So there's this. How to make an electric arc furnace. Let me.
Chances are you've thrown these things in the trash without even knowing.
Okay, so here's that. Take a look at that. And he shows in there how he's using these fire blocks. Like, let's see, what's he call them? And I think that's what we want. You can mill them out. So basically, take a solid block. Here, let's see what he calls it.
Side and use a 3/8-inch drill bit to burrow down. Could rip the brick apart, so let's take it slow. Out the reaction chamber and giving the
Yeah,
furnace
those are the lightweight
under the edges.
tire brake. Okay, so you know where to get that?
Yeah, I think you can get them on eBay.
Okay. Let's look at that. What if we took one of
Quote
those?
when I bought it.
So here's what I'm thinking. What if we take that, you stick a pipe in through that so that I mean, it basically boils down to where the charcoal hits the oxygen. So the this if we drill this out, that's going to be the air conduit. So it's basically our own long nozzle, essentially, right? And then the cave in of the charcoal on the outside of that, we can control where the burn zone is away from the tube. So the tube sticks in like with a decent tight fit. You kind of like make a nice tight fit into the tube. But it doesn't have any charcoal there, so would that still melt if there's no charcoal there? So that should be good. You want to try that? Seems like that would simplify the fire brick idea, and it could potentially be a good lowbrow solution instead of the ceramic nozzles.
Right, the trouble with the ceramic nozzles, you can probably get them at a welding supply, but what if your nearest welding supply is 100 miles away?
Yeah.
The
In
thing
which
too
case,
is, with fire brick. Suppose you live in the south. I don't know if you can go to any store and get fire. If you had to buy fire brick, did you get them in your area?
I'm sure you can. But I think the concept here is, like, I'm not too concerned. As long as the theory behind it is simple enough, like, I think Firebrick, we can open source eventually. I don't think it would be too hard. It's just, I guess, a certain type of clay, or is it gypsum, or whatever it is. I'm sure those resources are not scarce. Because that's been, I mean, Firebrick has been around, right? So I don't think we run into issues there. That's something we can probably make from our own clays here, or we got limestone here. I don't know, some kind of a fluffed expanded limestone or something. I think that's tractable, so I wouldn't worry about it right now, given that it's probably not a scarce resource. The ceramic nozzles are probably a little harder to get, but I think these fire bricks, that's probably, in the long run, it might even be a better idea than the nozzles, because the nozzles are still going to burn up after some time. And I think the brick, well, no, I'm just guessing here, but definitely bricks brick is crack. A, bricks will crack.
Yep.
Yeah.
Eventually.
Yeah. Yeah. So definitely this is an area worth exploring. As far as a decent solution for now, that can get you a good number of hours, firebrick's probably a decent idea. It might be that, potentially a solution could be that, I'm just speculating, but have a firebrick where you got perhaps multiple smaller entrances into the can, so that the heat is not concentrated in one fire zone, or maybe like multiple smaller ones, perhaps, or just more distributed. I don't know. But for now, I mean, just do the simple one inlet. So do we want to try the fire brick with a hole?
If it's possible to saw them, cut them.
Yeah, according to in that video with the a minute 108 of the video I just sent you, he's cutting them with a handsaw. And he's milling them with...
Help channel the dust and prevent the blade from scratching the table when it cut through. Okay, the three lines are cut, and you can see they separate the brick into four pieces. I designed it this way so that one fire brick will make two fur to target the exact center of the brick, and doesn't take much of an effort to begin chewing away...
Yeah, he's using like a regular drill to, with this big bit, to drill a hole through that.
Those are lightweight soft fire brick, which I've never used those. I'd like to sometime. I think they probably work good.
Do you want to try that then? That's sounds like a decent idea. Okay, let's try that. So use soft fire brick. Use soft fire brick. Okay. That'll be good. So, how big was the aperture in your bricks? It was like, you know, 4 by 4 inches or so?
Smaller than that, I think. Like in the picture where it shows the other vitrified.
Yeah.
It's probably 1.5 inches wide by 4 inches high.
1.5 inches by 4, about?
Yeah, roughly.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so yeah. So definitely, I mean, so we're devising the system right now. In the future, if we want to tighten this up, it does seem that the burn area, which is basically like if we wanted to do a heat exchanger around that, that's where we would take the heat exchanger. But the burn area, what do you estimate? Do you have a feeling for what that is, like the burn zone?
Might be a sphere that's maybe 18 inches in diameter.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to tell though where it actually transitions from burning to reacting.
Mm-hmm.
Is where the air hits it, there's combustion, but then there's a lot of heat that gets absorbed. So where it's actually changing, yeah. It's kind of hard to say. And with the lumina, the faster you tried to go, the bigger the burn zone got. So it depends how much demand you're making.
Mm-hmm.
The harder you step on the throttle, bigger that burn zone gets.
Yeah.
If you're just idling along and not using much power, it's going to shrink down and not be as hot,
mm-hmm.
not be as large. And if you use really coarse charcoal, if you don't crush up the charcoal enough,
mm-hmm.
then you have channels. And you, instead of a nice round small burn zone, you have hot spots. Because you get gases following a channel.
Oh yeah.
That's defined by large chunks of charcoal.
Yeah. Okay. So fuel quality is important. How much ash did you have in that system? Do we have to worry about ash clean out? Yeah, right.
Yeah, that's a really good question.
We should devise an ash door at the bottom.
Yeah.
Now let's think about this.
On the opposite side.
Okay.
On the bottom.
So let's think about this. Do we want to just use a simple drum at this point, or do we want to use a cubic shape that we put on top of the power cube, a slightly flattened out cubic shape, where the bottom maybe. So if you have the fire brick there, see like the cubic is not good in the sense that there's too much flat. I mean the charcoal won't get to the. Do you think if we have a flattened shape, all the charcoal will burn? No, it'll be really bad, right? You want it very tall.
Oh yeah, you want.
Taller than.
Yeah, you want tall and skinny, I think.
Right. See, how do we accommodate that for our case? Because that makes it really inconvenient for if it's on the top of the power cube. It really appears like it's got to be on the side. What if we try to flatten out? Okay, because I'm thinking about form factors and convenience here. Like if it's a drum, it's going to take more space than a flattened out cubic thing. Can we do something that's very cubic and flat, like maybe like 12 inches wide and like tall, like cubic shape? I think that would be workable.
12 inches wide and tall. I'm not sure what you mean.
Like a cube that's cubic shape that's like 12 by 36 by 36, or even 6 by 36 by 36. 6 is too thin.
Yeah.
I don't know. Maybe.
The only reason that mine was round. Any of mine were round is because it was easy to find round containers.
Right.
I would have made it square if I had square steel boxes.
Okay.
Airtight.
What if
there's no reason for it to be round.
Okay. So I'm thinking, what if we, in order, because see, I'm trying to think about how it's ever going to fit on a micro tractor or somewhere. If we made it like flat on the side, that would be a pretty, or like even a flat on the back, like where the driver stands. It's actually between a, what I could see working out is a power cube that's right in front of the driver. The gasifier is right in front of the driver. The walk behind driver guy. So it's like, you think we could make it 36 by 6 by 36, like a pancake? I mean, 6 inches would totally fit without a problem.
It stood on.
Or 8 inches even.
36 inches high.
Yeah, the cube, power cube right now is 36 by 36 by 32 high. So it's 3 feet, 3 feet, and then a little less than 3 feet high. If we just put this pancake right in the front of it, that could be workable for form factor, that you can actually use this thing without tipping over or not being able to see. Huh.
Yeah.
If it's like 36 wide, can we make this elongated burn zone? Probably, why not? Wait, let's see, what's the limiting factor for gas flow? The gas flow has to go in between the spaces in the charcoal? And,
yeah.
Right.
And I'm told, on the drive-on wood forums,
mm-hmm.
Just about everybody told me that my charcoal was too coarse, and I should have crushed it a lot finer.
How fine do you want it?
Well, did you see my Trommel video?
No, I haven't. Can you link that?
Let me send you a link to that. So in that video you can get kind of an idea of the size. Video of my trommel.
Wow. Okay. Oh wow. So yeah, yours is pretty big. So you want it like quarter inch, maybe? Half inch? You got like maybe up to an inch?
Yeah. And the trommel is 5 gallon.
It's a roller mill? Rod mill, essentially, right?
Yeah.
Wow.
That's bad enough for my job.
Great. Yeah, okay. That's interesting. And how'd you generate the charcoal? What do you use for the charcoal generation?
Three methods. The Haitian barrel method that we've discussed mm-hmm. already, and my wood stove, and burning brush piles.
Mm.
Like, I have Scotch pine on my property, and I don't like it.
Mm-hmm.
I get rid of it and burn it up.
Mm-hmm.
So I cut it down and pile up the brush and set fire to the brush. You know, branches, limbs, whatever. That's too small to cut up for wood. End up with a big pile of glowing embers. And then I'll take a barrel, 55-gallon barrel out there, and shovel the embers into the barrel and put the lid on it.
I see.
And it smothers the embers, and then I run them through that trommel.
Mm-hmm. And the consideration there is
different sizes of screens.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Buckets are cheap or free.
Have you thought about continuous production of charcoal?
yeah, I've thought about it.
Do you see any clear solutions?
No.
I think that's, when I think about it, I think that's might be pellets from sawdust or pelletized grass. I don't know. We'll see. We'll see down the road. So a flowable, augurable fuel like pellets would be, I think, a pretty easy way to do it. But you have to definitely have this extra energy to generate the pellets, and that's definitely not super easy. Then there's also, so you know, the Limit screw chippers. That sounds like that might be an alternative to the pellets. If you could get very tiny quality chips that are not jagged on the edges, that would be nice. But I don't know. We'll see. Okay, that's for later. If you talk about the Haitian barrel method, any links for that? So a barrel with a chimney on top of it?
No, not even that. Just a barrel with a lid. You take a barrel and you knock out both ends. And you just set it on three bricks on the ground.
Yep.
Pile it full of wood. Start it on fire.
From the top?
From the top.
Yep. Yep.
You let it burn down until you have no more yellow flame, and you'll burn most of the wood, and you get about the last ring, the bottom of the barrel, like a third of the barrel,
mm-hmm.
will be charcoal. And when it gets down to where you don't have yellow flame anymore, and it would depend. If you use soft wood like pine, it's going to burn way down in. If you use hard wood, it might not burn down so far. So after maybe 2 hours of burning, it's down to where it's blue flame, and then you put the lid on top, and you take out the bricks at the bottom, and you pile up sand around the bottom of the barrel, and you come back the next day, and it's perfect charcoal. But it's not very efficient. You don't get much charcoal for the amount of wood you have to put in it. Most of it goes up in heat.
So you got a bunch of, so you see a yellow flame coming out the hole at the top?
Yep. You get a big yellow fire for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And finally, once it's burned way down till there's no more yellow, when you see yellow flames, that's tar. You want it, and you're getting rid of the tar. So once it's down to no more yellow, then you're good. Then you smother the fire. You could have 10 barrels. If you want to talk about continuous charcoal production, you just have 10 different barrels, and by the time you're starting the fire in the last one, the first one's probably done. And I know some people put out the charcoal with water, then they have to dry the water out of it.
What if you just limited, like if you don't take the bottom out, but the holes were smaller on the bottom and the chimney was also thinner, is that a way to get it to, you get more yield, it'll just take longer? Starve more air?
It would take longer, and I don't know if you would get more.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it would be more efficient.
What's the next step? Go ahead.
When you light the fire from the top, it starts to turn to charcoal on top. And the fire is underneath. The fire is between where the charcoal and the raw wood is. And when that fire goes up through the charcoal, there's not The charcoal itself doesn't burn anymore because there's not enough oxygen to burn it.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't know. I think there's definitely more efficient ways.
So,
but it's so easy and cheap that it's right. tempting to use.
So what's the next level up of efficiency? What's the next kind of style? Are you familiar with the next style of charcoal maker?
Not really. There was a design that I saw a while back. I don't remember the name of it. It was more of a square kiln type of a thing. Let's see if I can find that. To look around to find that. I don't remember where it was. But it was a very similar idea. You just put it full of wood and burn it for a while and then smother it.
Mm-hmm.
The most efficient thing is to use a wood stove because you're using the heat if you do it in the winter when you need the heat.
Yeah.
But the firebox in my stove isn't very big, so it doesn't make a big batch like the Haitian barrel method.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't make lots of charcoal really fast.
If you use the Haitian barrel, you'll end up with one, like if you fill it, it's going to be like one third the barrel.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay. And how long does that take?
2 or 3 hours.
And the top is totally open?
Yep.
But ends up burning too much stuff. I mean, if you plug up the hole at the top, I mean, wouldn't that get you more quantity or not really?
Maybe.
Okay.
Might make more smoke. Not sure.
Yeah, I've got a little experience with gasifiers. Basically, the tall columnar ones, just simple cans with the bottom open. I guess what I could see if you put a chimney on that and... I don't have enough experience to understand how I would completely get the burn, so you're not burning the charcoal. Yeah.
Here's a video from Gary Gilmore.
Making charcoal?
Yeah. He's basically using the Haitian barrel method.
See, so he's punching. Yeah, that's what I would do. I would also do that. Not too much. Don't take the bottom out. You get a complete burn. I can tell you that. I like that. And then... So you pump little holes. Take the top out completely. It's probably that if you do stack a couple on top of one another, is that what he's doing? Looks like that's what he's doing, right? Yep.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, it looks like he's doing that.
The reason that some people use a chimney, I think, is they can put some air, you can have little air holes at the base of the chimney and it helps to burn. Instead of making smoke. Mm-hmm. Especially if you live in a neighborhood that's going to be fussy about making a lot of smoke.
Yeah.
You want a fire, not just belching out smoke.
Yep, so he, in that video he shows part two. Let's see, where's part two? I think we should do something like a columnar one. Wait, is that part three? Yeah, there's part three. Where's part two? Yeah, so he's got two barrels, one on top of another, and that's for... Yeah, let's do something like that, yeah? Just follow what he's doing. What I could see, if the holes on the bottom are small enough, you probably don't have to worry about the charcoal burning out. Oh, so he just buries it at the end. Okay. Yeah, we could definitely do something like that. But he's not... Did you look at that video yourself?
Yeah, I'm watching it.
Right. Yeah, so basically by putting on the big chimney on top, you prevent the air from getting into the top. Yeah, yeah, that makes sense to me. Just like the big chimney, it would prevent the air from going into the top. But you have to have enough chimney so that there's enough draft.
Yep.
Yeah, so I have a little bit of understanding of that because I played a lot with the bottom-out gasifiers. Yeah, okay, let's do something like that. Okay, so we can do something to that effect. Char maker. Have you contacted Gary Gilmore before? Or?
No, not directly. I think he might have commented on my post on Drive On Wood.
Okay.
When I posted the Lumina stuff, but I haven't had really direct conversation with him, no.
Okay. That's good there. So we can definitely do something of that nature. I'm thinking the secret there is going tall. So you have more volume, it just drops down into, just got more. More
yep,
produced.
I would agree with that.
Yeah.
Use big barrels. Use big 55
yeah.
gallon barrel. He's using a 35, which makes smaller batch.
Yeah. Can you hold on just a sec here?
Yep.
So can do that. So I think we're good on a burn chamber. We can do that. So can we go maybe forward a little bit on the other elements of the design that we definitely want to do?
Sure.
So send me a link. Can you give me a link to the cyclone? So that's a teal. What is it?
Yeah, I'll see here in just a minute. That gives you a good Google search of pictures of what I'm referring to. These are big, gigantic things for dust collectors.
Mm-hmm.
But it would be scaled down to more the size of the volume that an engine would draw.
Do you have a specific version that you like?
No, in fact, I've never used, a cyclone with my Gasifier. So I can't say from experience what works. I made a dust collector. I use this.
Uh-huh.
But the only reason the reason I'm suggesting this is because I know it works really well with dust collection, and I know that people like to put cyclones on their charcoal gasifiers, and it helps get the dust out, and it also helps to cool down the gas if it's a little bit hot. Usually it's not very hot, but if it is, any amount of heat you can reduce from it is beneficial.
Yeah. So here's one.
It would be metal instead of wood.
So take a look at that one. So basically so it's a disc like that. I see. I guess it's probably, but where's the drop out the dust?
It just shows the top part on the wood gears.
Uh-huh.
Picture that you sent. You just put a round cylindrical container on the bottom.
And let's see.
Could be a steel 5-gallon pail.
Where is the drop down from the baffle to the collection chamber on along the circumference, so that part in the picture that I sent you, the part that's white, almost going all the way around, that's where the hole is to drop to the bottom.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
I like this. Because the advantage is the simplicity over cyclones, over the conical shape, right?
Yeah, it's harder to make a cone, to fabricate a cone.
Yeah.
And it may actually be necessary or beneficial or important to have the cylinder straight with the theme baffle. I'm not sure about that. I think maybe it's probably the most important is the top part, and where it drops down from there is less important. But it's just easier to have a cylinder instead of a cone.
So scaled down quite a bit to, I see.
Maybe a steel pail like this. Or even less, maybe a coffee can sized container. Do you have a slip roll? You can make cylinders and weld them?
No. No, but maybe... but we do have 3-inch shaft. I thought about making a slip rod thing for making cylinders.
Right. Like with heavier gauge steel, like this 5-gallon pail that I linked is 29 gauge. That's really thin metal. You could almost cut that with a scissors.
Mm-hmm.
It might rust out. It could rust out quickly. But that's an idea of the size, I think, of the scale of something like that.
What do you think of this one from Harbor Freight? Is that... Is that big enough?
This hand-powered slip roll for northern industrial tools is just right for light manufacturing or sheet metal shop. The parallel rolls produce 2-inch diameter steel tubing, galvanized steel ducts, and other cylinders. And reverse rolling creates tubes with the same or a slightly larger diameter. It easily rolls metal up to 36 inches wide, with a minimum rolling radius of 1 inch. Looking for a way to easily roll metal in your manufacturing business or custom metal shop? Then check out this hand-powered slip roll from Northern Industrial Tools.
That's something I think we want to make out of 3-inch solid shaft. Okay.
Have you read Dave Gingrey's books?
Yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm. Let's see. So here for the thin baffle. So do one that, what do you say, like, say 6-12 inches across, perhaps. 6 inches might do it. Coffee can size. Yeah, something to that effect. I saw on the Crossfire, he had one it's basically a cylinder. It wasn't conical at the bottom. It was just a flat cylinder just going down. And basically it was the same thing. It was a pretty small diameter. It was actually more like 4 inches.
Yeah.
So I want to use something that small even. I guess it's
probably important that it's not too big. There's some things that have to be small in order to get the velocity.
Hmm.
If it's too big, the rotation, the centrifugal effect of it isn't going to work if it's too big.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm not sure. I haven't gotten too much into the science of that.
Do you know why the cyclone has to be tapered on the bottom?
No. I don't. Probably just to make... is when the particles fall down, you want them to fall into a funnel. But I don't know for sure.
I think the only reason there is... I would imagine that might be the case. What if we do something that's a mixture between the two for simplicity of fabrication, like they had in Crossfire, where they basically had a cyclone, but the tube just continued. It wasn't tapered. It just was a tube. So that means a teen baffle minus that separator part. Which would work better? Because the cyclone, what's nice about the cyclone is that tube goes down a bit more. And the teen, it goes... Yeah, I'm thinking, is the teen... A cyclone that's without the taper cone at the bottom, that sounds like it's simpler to make than a teen baffle, actually.
Yeah. And I think the teen baffle part of the idea is to pre prevent turbulence down lower where the dust is collecting. It's to help to prevent turbulence down there from blowing chips, like in a dust collector. You don't want the chips to be blowing around in there and coming back up.
Right.
So the baffle is there to help prevent that. And that may or may not be as much of an issue with dust from a gasifier.
Are people using the team baffle for gasifiers?
Not that I know of. It's just, I know that it works so well for dust that I think it would work good for a gasifier, but I don't really know.
It might be that in a gas case, in a vacuum cleaner case, it might rely on the much higher velocity, maybe. Maybe.
Yeah.
I don't know. I would say let's just stick with the cyclone thing without the cone on the bottom like they're doing, like Troy's doing on the crossfire.
Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so next item would be what else? So we got cyclone, gas speed blower. For start, so let's see, maybe look at the,
let me close the window here.
Got a thunderstorm here. So just going through your page 7, 8, and 9, let's do that. So let's try for, should we try for a square shape? I would say, how important is the air tightness of that? It's pretty important, right? You got to have a complete closed off from the outside.
Because if you get air leaking in, then you get
fire zones,
explosions.
Yeah.
They'll sneeze.
Right.
And if when you shut down, you have to make sure that gas or that air, that fresh air, doesn't go backwards into the exit.
Yeah. So see, the geometry question right now, to do it a flat thing, it means we're doing it for practical purposes, but there's a bunch of fabrication going on there, so maybe just keep it to the cylinder for now. What are your thoughts on that? Should we try to actually address the fit, the geometrical compatibility, or just having it work? Because the square geometry gets us into the issues of there's an unknown with respect to how the fuel is going to drop down in there. And I mean, just a little bit of a variable.
Yeah, especially at the corners, if the bottom could be internally tapered. I mean, it could look square but have tapered guides. Take a little bit of space.
I'm just looking at the fabrication part. That means just welding up a whole cube. That's a bunch of welding.
Yeah.
We could avoid. I don't know, maybe just avoid it for now. Do you think that in a super tiny, like a 5 gallon size, do you think we can get enough gas flow out of that? Yeah, I mean, if we had the apertures big enough, right?
5 gallon?
Yeah. Or like 5 gallon, like 10 gallon, like just basically the size of 12 inch diameter pail, but two of them, let's say. I don't know, I'm just kind of exploring, like, what if the test were to just optimize for one, well, for understanding that, oh, even in this 5 gallon space you could get enough gas pending pending that you have the apertures big enough. And then maybe, what if we just, I don't know, because we can do some basically like get this to be a more experimental workshop where we say, okay, now we've got this small space. What if we made it like a chimney stack where you can stack the next section for more volume?
Yeah, use 8-inch pipe.
Possibly.
Gary Gilmore's first one of his simple fire design used a 5-gallon pump line.
Yeah, I mean, 5-gallon would work. Yeah, that one. Yep. That's good. An interesting experiment would be to see if a system like that, because then we can definitely go vertical. What if we try to design a pail like that, and then we can put like infinite sections of addition on top? Because if we can show that this can do like 27 horse or possibly even more, is that worth it? Showing that we can stack these sections one on top of each other. If we made the gas exit in the bottom section, that would still work, right? The gas exit doesn't have to be in the top section, right?
Right. It doesn't have to be all the way at the top. It needs to be up a little ways to be away from the burn zone. But it doesn't have to be all the way at the top.
Yeah. This stackability idea sounds good to me. I don't know. Do we have any other examples where they're doing these like 12-inch gasifiers that are actually putting out a lot of power? Or they're typically a little fatter?
I think they're bigger.
Yeah, I mean, they're typically bigger. If we just do like what we know that people have done. Yeah, but those are actually running on wood. Does that make a difference? Typically?
What is?
Well, like the fatter gasifiers that we saw in cars, they're typically fatter. But were they fatter because they're running on wood, or it's, or the charcoal would have to be just as fat?
They just have to be bigger. Chris Seymour, I think, who is no longer living. Here, let me paste the link. There, he's pulling it on a trailer.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's based on 55-gallon drums. And that's charcoal. And he's got cooling and filtration. Well, I think one of those barrels is dedicated to filtration. So, I think they do have to get larger diameter unless you can insulate it with refractory kind of fire brick. Because the burn zone is like a sphere.
Mm-hmm.
It wants to get bigger in all directions.
Yeah. Right. It's probably, if you wanted to minimize welding, probably the best thing is a vertical propane tank, like a... Yeah. Like a 100-pound tank kind of setup. That would definitely get us, you know, get us to kind of... It, I mean, it could potentially still burn out. I mean, the easiest way to be sure is like do like a 35-gallon drum. That would be a pretty, probably a sure bet. When you had the hot spot on your gasifier, was that because of the leak?
Yes.
Otherwise, you were
working properly. Hmm. There is very little heat on the site. You know, not enough to burn the paint really.
But it was hot. I mean, definitely hot, hotter than you can touch. But
yeah, mm-hmm. Somewhat.
Uh huh. Do you know if that was at high throttle, or was that at high throttle, or?
Yeah, it definitely got hotter when I was driving as opposed to just sitting there with the engine idling.
Yeah. Right.
But one thing I found is that I couldn't, when I was pressing on the accelerator, after pressing it down more than halfway, it didn't have more power. But I think that might have been the size of the hose going from the back to the front.
Mm-hmm. Refractory, so just clear, burn the metal, eh? Is there a way to, what if we had the fire brick and we made basically like spread the fire zone out by making like multiple holes, so there's multiple inlets instead of one place. So more like columnar, like more taller. Nah. I don't know, like we can try spreading out the flame zone or doing like smaller.
It might work, but I don't know.
Yeah, this is just
experimented.
Yeah. The only safe bet is doing like the 35 drum or 55 drum. So I guess it probably leads us to the thought that if we just use a simple drum, we don't really get the, I mean, as far as putting it on a micro track, it's going to be hard to mount it anywhere unless, yeah. I mean, what are your thoughts on how do we mount it? Like, cause I mean, it could be a good case for, okay, just showing that we did it, but if it's not too practical, is that okay for now?
Right.
Cause I mean,
my tracker, I had it on the back.
Yep.
Right behind where I sat.
Yep.
But later, I thought that it might have been better for it to be on the front, off to one side. Not right straight in front of me in my field of view, but a little bit off to one side. Or maybe completely on one side.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I think that would have been better.
How heavy was that unit?
£40, maybe.
£40, and were you guessing for the? Well, what was the container there? That was.
That red container is a. That was a 20-gallon water tank.
20-gallon water tank.
Mm-hmm. Well, it was listed as 20 gallons, but it had an air bladder. It had been a well tank. So the actual capacity might have been more like 30 because of the air bladder. It was designed for 20 gallons filling and emptying.
I see.
Of the chamber.
And that part, so that was, did that get super hot or?
Nope. That stayed pretty cool. There was very little, almost no scorching of the paint with that.
You had about 10 hours on that?
No, that was kind of a guess for how long the nozzle lasted. But to actually do work with it, I could maybe run it for an hour, working mm-hmm. it really hard with doing snow blowing.
Mm-hmm.
And then when it started to run out of charcoal, it would just start getting less mixture and the outlet pipe would start to get hot. So I feel the outlet pipe, and when it started to get hot, then I knew that I needed to stop and open it up and add more charcoal. And the method of adding charcoal to it wasn't good. I had the whole top on a hinge. I don't know if you're looking at those pictures.
Mm-hmm.
That was really inconvenient. That wasn't a good design. You had to open the whole thing up
mm-hmm.
like that to add more. So I would have been, I would improve that, make a better filling port. And with the Lumina, I had the filling port also serve as the pop valve. So if it exploded, it would pop open that instead of blowing up the whole thing.
Mm-hmm. Let's see, the red can, it's like what, it's broken in half?
Yep. I sawed it in half and put a hinge.
Yeah.
And then a band with silicone sealant, it would tighten around the joint. That worked good. It didn't leak air.
Mm-hmm.
But filling it was a pain.
And to fill this one, in our case, like say it's a 35-gallon drum, what would you suggest? Just the same as an Illumina?
Right. Almost all the wood gasifier and charcoal gasifier designs that I've seen, the filling lid is on some kind of a spring.
Mm-hmm.
So that if you get an explosion, it just pops the lid up.
Okay.
And when you open it up to add more fuel, the latch is some kind of a spring.
How do explosions happen? By pockets of gas?
Yeah, usually if it's an air leak, get an air leak, or if the air goes backwards, you get fresh air back down into the outlet pipe. With the Lumina, I never had any explosions at all. And with the tractor, I never had really bad ones. Nothing that popped it open.
Mm-hmm.
It just made a funny sound, and I think maybe a puff of fire came out of the intake at the bottom.
Yeah.
But on YouTube, I've seen videos of people that had much bigger explosions that they could have got hurt. And the idea is, if you have a pop valve, it can let the pressure out. It can let a lot of pressure out quickly, then that's better. Because there's somewhere for the gases to go instead of something breaking.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Okay. Right. So yeah, okay, we've been talking for a good 2 hours now. Let's see, what should we do here? Let's see, how much do we cover today? We were gonna try to cover basic scope of the design. So do we achieve that? So let's see. So we decided on probably the simple cyclone hearth design with a fire brick, the soft fire brick with tube. Refill port pop valve, so just take the one from the Lumina design.
Right. I use the plastic toilet flange and
okay.
a flat piece of metal with, I mean, we can improve lots of things about that.
Yep.
A valve that, you know, a design that when you put suction onto it, the valve actually pulls itself shut tighter.
Yeah. Okay.
Not sure if the pictures of my Lumina show that real well.
I have to take a look at that. Mm-hmm. Do you think so back on to page 8, exhaust gas recirculation, you think that's pretty feasible? It's we've got a muffler outlet that I think that would be quite feasible, right?
Yeah.
If you shoot all the exhaust gas in it, you'd put out the fire.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So
or at least it would stop the reaction to where the engine would stall.
Yeah. Now, if you're sucking hard on the gas, like if you have a big, big aperture that you're just gonna really heat this up, right? And or will the engine actually be limiting that? Well, if you have big pipes, you probably just produce so much that you over rev the engine, or is what's the feedback to reduce the rate of the flame? I mean, you have to close down ports, right? Otherwise, it will just go out of control. Close the air inlet.
Well, if the engine is running at full throttle, it's still only going to draw a certain amount of gas. And not more.
Uh-huh. So the only thing that can happen, if you have too big of a port, like it could actually start... I mean, it's totally limited by the engine, isn't it?
Right. If you have a carburetor, you know, you have an engine that has a 3/4 inch intake,
mm-hmm.
It's only going to suck so much air and gas.
Mm-hmm.
And if it's, you know, an engine that's only running at 3,600 RPM,
mm-hmm.
And it has a certain displacement, it's a limited amount of air that it's pulling in.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, so EGR, yes, yeah? I mean, we could probably do that.
Yeah, it's a good idea to help control heat.
If you don't have EGR, is it easy to throttle down the air intake, or...?
No, you just get way more heat than you need. You burn up the hearth. You probably waste some heat some of the heat just goes out through the barrel and is lost.
Mm-hmm. But why doesn't, do you have a feeling for why, if you just really shut down the air, then it just can't burn fast enough, right? Or does it really, like, suck very hard and it's very hard to control it?
No, it's more that there's too much oxygen. Air is 21% oxygen.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Yeah.
That's just too much.
Mm-hmm.
More rich with oxygen than what the combustion. Even a car that runs on gasoline
mm-hmm.
has an EGR. It's just because air, regular natural atmospheric air, has just a little too much oxygen to be perfect. So even a car that runs on gasoline has an EGR valve and is taking some exhaust and it's bringing it back into the intake to help the gasoline from not burning too hot.
What do you mean by it? I don't understand that so much. If you just decrease the amount of oxygen, doesn't that fix everything? I mean, just by closing down the air intake. That doesn't work like that?
No, because then you're using air too. And air expansion is what pushes the piston down.
I
the
see.
Other 78% of air is nitrogen.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get nitrogen too hot, it will start to burn. And then you have NOx,
mm-hmm.
oxides of nitrogen, that's poisonous, polluting.
Yeah.
That's another reason for cooling the heat of combustion. You don't need more. You have too much heat, more than you really need. You have other problems like detonation or pinging.
Yeah.
And that's completely within the scope of gasoline-powered engines, not even charcoal, that have EGR circuits.
Yeah. I see. Okay.
There's probably a good discussion of that online on maybe there's, I don't know,
Yeah,
here we go.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, so I think, you know, if we use a 35 or 55 gallon drum, we probably just want to observe it for, you know, like do a stationary power cube application, perhaps. I mean, it'd be nice to drive the tractor, but let's see, like, if we use that full size, what are your thoughts on where we're going to mount the system? I mean, will we have room on the side? I mean, it'll basically be pretty awkward, but if it's just a 55-gallon drum, that's actually not, you know, say it's a big, fat 55-gallon drum. Actually, let's see, the amount of weight...
24-inch. I think the drum is 24 inches or so.
Yeah, actually, that's not too bad. Because the weight in it, like if it were water, it's like 500 pounds. How much is the weight of the charcoal in there? Like 100 pounds or?
Probably not even 100 pounds. Maybe 70 or 80 pounds.
70, 80 pounds. So, I mean, that's still doable. Just hang it, you know, just hang it right off the edge of the tractor. I mean, it's not like it's going to weigh it down or make it flip. I mean, the power cube itself is going to be 500 pounds or more. It's so yeah. No, I think that's going to be fine. We can run the tractor with it. Just hang it off the side. Question would be like, what kind of form factor do we just maybe put some brackets on this 55-gallon drum so we could just hang it off the tractor? I guess we have to decide that. But something simple. Maybe it could be a whole frame, like another cube, but in this application, if you could have too many corners that could get in the way. Maybe just a simple drum is just okay.
I hope that there's an opportunity to test that before the workshop.
Yeah, to test how we just hang it off the microtractor?
Yeah, test everything, really.
Oh, yeah.
I don't know.
No, I mean, that's the goal. That's why I just keep it to the simplest proven. So drum, yeah. I think just put some belts on it and hang it off like a... We're going to have like a... Just some kind of a hanging attach off the side, definitely. I mean, we can actually... Actually, one way to do it is you can put it right on a loader. Just put the gasifier on the loader. Loader arms. Right? Or actually,
yeah, certainly.
You know, if we do the, so if it's 2 feet, that definitely fits within the size of a power cube frame. If we make it structural, like we do for the rest of the frame, then we can actually hang the loaders off the structural gasifier frame. So we can actually have a,
That picture that I just sent, that shows the uni strut. I used to mount the barrel on my Lumina. That's, if you've worked with uni strut, it's real cheap and easy to work with.
Yep.
So that's not very heavy. You can tell the barrel isn't holding 500 pounds for sure.
Yeah.
It probably could. Uni strut is really strong.
Open source charcoal gas bomb.
But, yeah, it's. Fairly trivial mounting right there.
Okay. Yeah. No, I think we can do something like that. So for simplicity's sake right now, well, actually, you know, there's two ways to go. If we want to make it practical, okay, hold on. Let me just paste in a couple of these links. We have to kind of like decide on the scope of how practical we want to make it. Like, are we really shooting for that or this is just the first test? I'm just capturing the links you just sent me here. Oh, by the way, do you know any other vehicles, cars that are running on charcoal, not wood? Besides the van? Because I thought yours was the only one that ran on charcoal.
No, there's a number of them.
Okay.
If you look at that drive on wood, somebody took one of those little geo tracker.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a miniature SUV.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, there's a whole channel on that site that's about charcoal.
Okay, so there's a whole bunch of others that have actually done it?
Yeah, I think so.
They're going for something more complicated than what you're doing, or?
Probably not. I'm not sure. Used to have it separated by. Used to have a category just for charcoal, and now I'm not seeing it. Small engines. Categories. Yeah, I don't know what happened to their charcoal category.
That's interesting.
Oh, here it is. Oh, small engines.
Yeah, but I mean, like, cars, not small things. Let's see. They got other cars there, or?
Hmm. one. Yacht.
There's a good discussion of open fire on the drive on wood, and then, yeah.
I should probably go. It's
yeah.
11 o'clock.
Okay.
Over here.
Okay, hold on just a sec. Yeah. Okay, so let's see. Yeah. What's our next step then? So I think we got a lot of this pretty much settled. Yeah, we still haven't really specified the whole thing, but what's your schedule look like for the coming days? Because from here on, we want to just finalize what we've. Yeah, I mean, we're talking, I guess there's a lot of decisions to make and all that. But we want to put it. We're definitely moving forward with some interesting concepts. This will be very exciting. Want to put this on, announce it as a workshop as soon as we can. So with that said, how's your schedule for next week looking?
Well, I have a full-time job.
Mm-hmm.
I could maybe, one of the things that I would like to try to do is to make some drawings with Blender.
Mm-hmm.
Just to help visualize some things.
Okay. So do you think we should go on, you know, like right now we can, as far as the announcement itself, we can possibly get it out there and make some commitments. Should we wait until we've got, if you're going to do some of the Blender stuff, should we wait until that's there to publicize, or it'll take a few more days? Like what I could probably do is just kind of try to scope out this thing from what we discussed, maybe run it by you.
Yeah.
And then we'll see how quickly we can get this thing posted.
Right.
So hopefully in the next few days. Because, I mean, we're pretty decent on time. I mean, if it's the 16th, we've got exactly 2 months. So, I mean, we're pretty decent. You want to announce it, and, you know, quicker the better. So people can start signing up and putting their in the calendars. So let's try to get it up online as soon as we can. I guess we can nail down some of the, what exactly is going to happen. And as soon as we agree to that and we have clarity, we should post it. So I guess next few days.
Right. Probably next Monday or Tuesday. Have another chat about it.
Okay. Okay. Next Monday or Tuesday, are you talking about a week from now or tomorrow? Tomorrow, Monday, Tuesday. No, I mean.
I don't know. Maybe that's too soon.
Yeah,
maybe
I mean.
In a week.
Yeah. So let's basically, like, let me just, you know, shoot back to you, you know, kind of like summarize what we discussed and kind of, you know, just go from there and just start nailing things down, see if we agree on what exactly we're going to do.
Yep.
And then, you know, we'll get it out there as soon as we can. Okay. Well, that sounds good. As far as trying to get some drawings of this, what kind of time frame were you thinking about that?
Probably at least a week.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we can potentially get, so Jean-Baptiste, who's our graphics guy, we can possibly try to get him to do an infographic Do you think that would be a good idea, or? Probably.
Yeah, I like those sketches that you have. Those are cool.
Yeah, I mean, if we were to do that, how would we portray it? As a standalone thing, just as a thing by itself, or show it with a power cube? Probably like on a power cube, something with a power cube.
Right.
I don't know.
Either just next to it, or mounted to it somehow.
If we could try like to soup up the microtractor with a gasifier unit on it, that might be. You think that would work, or that's getting a little crazy?
I don't know. Depends what you want. I know that one thing that I notice about you is that you like aesthetics.
Mm-hmm.
You have an artistic part element to your design. Just about everything.
Me?
And yeah, I think so. And then.
That's the opposite of what everyone else says.
Oh.
Maybe you actually see the true beauty. Maybe you're the first person.
Well, the fact that it's a cube.
Uh-huh.
Like, I wouldn't have thought of making it a cube. The things that I design tend to look more like a squashed bug.
Mm-hmm.
You know, with parts hanging out all over.
Yeah, I mean, for us, it's definitely the modularity, packageability, and practicality that's definitely... I mean, there's a total aesthetic to that, but most people don't appreciate it. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I'll see what we think. I'll think about it, see what we want. I mean, one easy thing would be, to draw the power cube up and then show the gasifier next to it, which would be interesting. So that we kind of start showing how the different machines fit together. Because I guess the microtrack is one explicit example of combining two things, the power cube and something else. And the rest of it, so is the microtractor, but yeah. Okay, I'll think about it. Be nice if we can get this for the workshop. I mean, eventually we will. Maybe like we can post the workshop and then get the infographic, or we'll just wait till the infographic, we'll see. We'll take a little bit of time. Mm-hmm. All right. Okay. Well, that sounds good. So yeah, we'll get rolling on this. Get our minds around the whole concept a little more, and go from there.
Yeah.
So I guess thanks a lot for spending the time. That was pretty epic. We can 2.5 hours, but
yeah.
I think we're moving forward. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anything else? Any other questions or concerns or anything? Or any other comments? Or
no, nothing that I can think of right now.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So if all's good, yeah, we'll be in touch on email. And yeah, I'll get you, try to start firming down some thoughts as soon as we can here. I'll try to get that to you as soon as I can. Yep. All right. Okay, so we'll be in touch, and yeah, thanks for the time. We'll continue.
Okay.
Then have a good night. Mm-hmm. Take care. Bye-bye.